Jesus said, "Live in me. Make your home in me, just as I do in you. In the same way that a branch can't bear grapes by itself, but only by being joined to the vine, you can't bear fruit unless you are joined with me. I am the vine. You are the branches. When you're joined with me and I with you, the relation intimate and organic, the harvest is sure to be abundant. Separated, you can't produce a thing. Anyone who separates from me is dead wood, gathered up and thrown on the bonfire. But if you make yourselves at home with me and my words are at home in you, you can be sure that whatever you ask will be listened to and acted upon. This is how my Father shows who he is. When you produce grapes, when you mature as my disciples, I've loved you the way my Father has loved me. Make yourselves at home in my love. If you keep my commands, you'll remain intimately at home in my love. That's what I've done, kept my Father's commands and made myself at home in his love. I've told you these things for a purpose, that my joy might be your joy and your joy wholly mature. This is my command. Love one another the way I love you. This is the best way to love. Put your life on the line for your friends. You are my friends when you do the things I command you. I no longer call you servants because servants don't understand what their masters are thinking and planning. No, I've named you friends because I've let you in on everything I've heard from my Father. You didn't choose me, remember. I chose you and put you in the world to bear fruit. Fruit that won't spoil. As fruit bearers, whatever you ask the Father in relation to me, he gives you. But remember the root command. Love one another. If you find the godless world is hating you, remember, it got its start hating me. If you lived on the world's terms, the world would love you as one of its own. But since I picked you to live on God's terms, and no longer on the world's terms, the world is going to hate you. When that happens, remember this. Servants don't get better treatment than their masters. If they beat on me, they will certainly beat on you. If they did what I told them, they will do what you tell them. They are going to do all these things to you because of the way they treated me, because they don't know the one who sent me. If I hadn't come and told them all this in plain language, it wouldn't be so bad. As it is, they have no excuse. Hate me, hate my Father, it's all the same. If I hadn't done what I've done among them, works no one has ever done, they wouldn't be to blame. But they saw the God signs and hated anyway, both me and my Father. Interesting. They have verified the truth of their own scriptures where it is written, they hated me for no good reason. When the advocate I plan to send you from the Father comes, the Spirit of truth issuing from the Father, he will confirm everything about me. You too. From your side, must give your confirming evidence, since you are in this with me from the start. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Please be seated. Grace and peace to you on this day from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. So this is the last Sunday of the Easter season. Pentecost is on its way with the promise of the coming Spirit. And here we are the third week in a row hearing Jesus talking to his disciples in the upper room. It's important to remember that this conversation he's having with them takes place before all the things had taken place. So before his betrayal, before his arrest, before his suffering, before his death, before being raised from the dead, and before, on this day, which we remember, ascending to be with the Father. All before. And he does this, having this conversation with them in long, long paragraphs, to prepare them. To prepare them for what is to come. All this teaching that we've heard over the last few weeks has come down really to just one word. Love. That's what he's teaching us to do. To love. Not your greeting card kind of love, but that self-giving, sacrificial, put your life on the line kind of love. That's the love that he's been offering. That's the love that he calls you and I and all those who follow him to join in. It's love that looks like what his ministry has been about this entire time, bringing light into the darkness. Reaching out to those who are on the outside looking in. Healing those who have been sick. Forgiving those who have sinned against God and one another. Challenging authority when it's necessary. And in these days that are to come as he's preparing them, that ultimate gift of love, his life offered on a cross for them and for you and for the sake of this world. Now it might sound like where that goes is to be cut off. After all, death is one of those things that feels like you're cut off from everything else. But listen to what he's talking about here. He says, I'm the vine. You are branches. I like the way this translation reads. Remember the root command. You're connected to the roots. What are the roots? The roots are that love that he offers. It is revealed through him. You can't grow grapes on a vine if it's cut off from the rest of it, can you? And what Jesus is reminding us and them is that when we remain in that love that he's given, as we serve in the way that we've called, as we receive this great gift that he offers, fruit will come, just as the Spirit is coming. And there's going to be a harvest. Today we remember also the Ascension, which this first reading in Acts is about. They go up, and they basically kind of say goodbye to Jesus. It says he is taken up into the clouds. And there's one of the great questions that is asked, I think, in the New Testament by those witnesses who are there, those angels. Why are you standing there, looking up at the sky? I love that. Today's about connection. It's about remaining connected. It's the promise of connection, especially when it feels like God is so far away, that we are cut off, that God is somehow absent in our world. It's easy to look at the world and feel like God is absent sometimes, especially this week as we hear of yet another attack on innocent people in Manchester, England. Kids at a concert, not much older than these three sitting up front. Just horrible, horrible thing. You start to ask, where's God in the middle of that? Where you've heard the story of those Christians in Egypt, our Coptic friends, neighbors, sisters, brothers, also attacked and lives taken. And you start to ask, well, where's God in the middle of that? Last Saturday, Joe and I, we went to New York City for the day. His idea. It's a good idea. And we saw some friends, and that was great. But one of the other things we decided to do is we went to the 9/11 memorial. Now, I've been down to Ground Zero a number of times. If you've ever been down there, there's that little church, St. Paul's, and they were the ones that hosted all the firefighters and rescue workers in the midst of that, and it's a great way to walk through and remember what happened and the way people stepped up to remain connected in the midst of that. But we didn't do that time. We got tickets to go to the 9/11 memorial, which I had not been to yet. And it's one of those things, you go down there and it's big. So the outline of one of the towers is where that reflection pool is. And there's a cascading wall of water that comes down to the bottom of it. And because there's so much water in the way that it's situated, you feel almost a coolness as you get close to it. And there's a mist that comes at you as well. It's very eerie. I can't think of another word to describe it. And then we went into the museum, which I didn't understand fully how it was, but you go way down, basically go down to the foundation where the building is. And they still have some steel beams exposed. And the main exhibit, you walk through, you wind around. They tell the story of the day and the days that followed. And I had expected to feel a little sad, and I expected to be reminded of all the events that happened and even think about where I was in those moments. But what I was not anticipating was how raw it still felt. A raw, open pain by everybody who was there, including myself. You've been exposed to pain like that for now almost close to 16 years. You start to ask yourself, where's God there? And yet this passage from Acts and this passage from John remind us of something. It's that question, why do you stand there looking at an empty sky? Don't we ask that of ourselves even? Where's God? And yet the promise comes. You are connected. You are connected. Even through all these things that will take place, as Jesus is betrayed and arrested and taken away and executed, and all of his friends running away in panic and in fear, thinking they too are cut off from God and from anything that was their future. And yet, Jesus reminds us of that promise. I'm the vine. You're the branches. You are connected. You are growing. You are rooted in that same place. The love that God gives, revealed through me, and that self-giving, sacrificial love for us all. Not to be cut off, but to grow and bring life. And in the Spirit that is coming, bear fruit in this world, even when it feels like it hates us. I heard a story on Tuesday that I've heard before, and I kind of remembered part of it, so I looked it up. And as I was looking up, I discovered something about this story, is that it was told multiple ways. And it was told from multiple locations. And it was told also from multiple times, which makes me think it's more legend than a historical event. But that being the case, there's still some real truth in this story that I'm about to tell you. This story, I've heard it told in Germany, France, and England after World War II, in the rubble. I heard one version of it in South Africa under apartheid and that regime. I heard one version of the story in LA after the riots that had happened there now almost 25 years ago. And this is how the story goes. So there is a church. Pick any church. Pick our church. And outside of it was a statue. A statue of Jesus. I think it's important to note in this story, in all the versions that I've heard and read, the statue is outside. It's not Jesus on the cross. It's not Jesus holding a little lamb. It's not even Jesus with a young child. It's the risen Jesus with hands open, arms open, to embrace the world, to bring a different kind of peace, to bring a joy that makes us whole, to remind us of who we are and what we're called to do, and that is to love this world in which we find ourselves. And in each of these stories, through an incident, usually something pretty violent, the statue and most of the church is destroyed. And in the cleanup, when people are sifting through the rubble, that statue is again rediscovered. Except it's broken. And there's some conversation around the people of what should be done about that. Should we find the artist and restore it? Should we make a new one? Should we put this somewhere? And in each version of this story, a wise person steps in and says, no, let's put it up exactly as it is, back outside. And this is what is broken about the statue. Its hands are missing. And this wise person reminds the church in the midst of the rubble, in the midst of asking, where is God in this? That who we are is to be Christ's hands in the world. The vine, the branches, fruit being bare. Now today, in a few minutes, we're going to invite Riley and Elena up front. We're going to pray for them. We're going to celebrate with them. We're going to congratulate them on a job well done. But know this, this is not the end. This is just the beginning. Because you ladies are the hands of Christ in the world. Just as all of us here, surrounding you, are also the hands of Christ in the world. Especially when we feel disconnected. I want to end today by reading an old poem. It's a poem by Teresa of Avila, who was a nun, a reformer, a mystic from the 16th century. She lived in Spain. And these words are attributed to her. Christ has no body on earth but yours. No hands but yours. No feet but yours. Yours are the eyes through which Christ's compassion for the world is to look out. Yours are the feet with which he is to go about doing good. And yours are the hands with which he is to bless us now. And in that blessing, let us continue to bless others wherever we are. Amen.